Dungeon Crawler Network presents Tales of Tamriel.
Welcome one, welcome all to episode 97 of Tales of Tamriel, a Dungeon Crawler Network production. I am your host, Aggelos, and I have kissy faces all over my face because it is Heart's Day. That is right. It's Heart's Day in Tamriel. Yuck, Avi.
I mean, yay. Happy Heart's Day, everybody.
Yay. Well, the man over there who apparently is not getting any love from that male Argonian who likes to swallow swords anymore. Avi, Optimal, how are you, sir?
I'm doing all right. I'm not a big fan of this day, and I'm not a big fan of male Argonians, but I like Tamriel, so that's good enough for me.
Right. I know you were super excited after the last episode, but now you're a little heartbroken. I guess the one with the skills to pay the bills wasn't necessarily fitting your type anymore, huh?
Yeah, I'm not into, and neither of them a moist male swallowing swords and DLC. So that's never any fun.
Well, you say that, but you're obviously drunk enough the first time to think she was a kitty.
This is true. Anyway.
I blame the alcohol.
Well, yeah, I guess that could happen. So,
and my bad graphics. I have excuses.
Yeah, blame the graphics. Yeah,
the graphics. It's clearly the graphics' fault. Yeah.
Let's move on from this.
All right. Well, we're gonna move on, and we're gonna move on by saying hello to one of our other hosts, the man you probably hear, Asteldian. How are you?
I'm doing very well, thanks. Did everyone have a good Valentine's Day?
Well, I did. I mean. It was enjoyable.
I got beer, so no complaints.
That makes every day good.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. Yeah. And also the fourth person on the stream right now, which I'm desperately attempting to fix the cameras because I had to adjust the size. Crabby, how are you, Crabby?
Oh, hi. Hello.
Yeah.
I'm watching the stream, and it's just like my face everywhere.
All of a sudden, everywhere, yeah.
Right now, I'm covering up Avi, and it is great. Apparently, it's my fault that it's so screwed up.
Hashtag blame today.
It is, actually. I jumped in here, messed with the screen, and now I have to desperately try to fix every... Oh, see, I'm back. That's awesome. But I do see your face everywhere, so, you know. That is a thing. So, Crabby, what have you been up to this past week since we haven't spoke to you a while? Why don't you go ahead and give us a little bit of what you've been up to recently while I fix things? Make it last.
Yeah, I don't even remember the last time I was on. Probably before I came back to the game, like 2 months ago before that. I mean, I don't know. But, I've been playing ESO a lot, a lot, and, you know, as much as I've gotten into it, I decided to do an endgame Friday night type thing, event thing. And, you know, this past Friday, you know, the turnout was a little low. The Friday before was actually really good.
It was my fault. I was sick. No one else wanted to show up.
That's fine. it's been fun, though. Like, what did we do? We did Arthurian Archives 2 weeks ago, and that was awesome. Awesome.
Yeah.
Like, I really want to get more into trials are really fun.
And a new one's coming out with this next patch, too, the Law of, Maul of Lorkaj. So, and apparently it's insanely difficult, as well as there's some really awesome gear that you can get from it, which we talked about in previous episodes.
Well, the thing with that is the Maul of Lorkaj is this is the first trial with a veteran mode.
Mm-hmm.
So the veteran mode, you know, I think the veteran mode is at VR16.
Yes.
Yeah. But I know the normal mode, you can scale it from level 10 to VR16. So that'll be awesome because I want to see if I can get the guild together to want to do, you know, trials. So that's what I'm going for.
Right. Well, yeah, we want to get some more people. And a special shout out, since I forgot to do it last episode because I got distracted by Khajiit, who swallows swords, and I totally forgot all my game time. Special shout out to Zakir, who actually I ran into him in Hrothgar. Yeah, I just randomly ran into someone in Hrothgar. I was doing world bosses. It was actually Kanjud, who was in our guild. Like, you'll notice he's in there, and he was asking for people to come out and do world bosses. And I was just doing crafting stuff. I'm like, yeah, I'll go. So I said, I'll go. And I randomly got a message going, oh, are you the guy from Dungeon Crawler Network? I'm like, yeah, that's me. So I got to talking with him and adding my friends list. He's a tank and everything. And he sent me a message like yesterday saying that if there's room, he's looking, you know, to expand, getting, you know, the guild he's in now. He loves the guild he's in now, but they don't do a lot of stuff together. And since we plan events in our guild, like three out of the nights, so he wants to hop in with us. So we'll have another tank, which is good, so Ark doesn't have to do it all.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to point out that, and you know, anybody who's listening, if you want to do casual, super casual trials, we're trying to do them Friday nights at 8:30 p.m. Eastern. So if you're interested in that, you know, try, you know, join the guild, Wings of Fate, or you know, hit up any of us on the game, and we'll see. So we need people.
When he says super casual, he means super casual. Half of us don't know what we're doing, so don't worry.
I think two of us knew how to do our Arthurian archives, and we wiped twice.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's fun.
No, it's fun. We're learning together. I think out of everyone that was there, I think I was the only one who, well, I shouldn't say that. I don't know for everyone, but I'm the only one that I know of personally. Now, there might have been one or two others, because there's one guy in there who's explaining and doing a good job for some of the fights, who's actually done all the current trials. I think almost everyone else was brand new, and we still got through it, so, and it was a fun time.
You and Mike, KDR Mickey.
KDR Mickey, yeah. Oh, yeah, I forgot. Yeah. KDR Mickey was, and there was one more person in there, I cannot remember the name, and I feel really bad, but they ran with us, and they were explaining certain things in the fight in chat to people if they got stuck, so that was cool.
Oh, yeah, and the trials will be on Ebonheart Pact side as well. That caused a little bit of an issue. Ebonheart Pact.
Which we'll talk about that a little later, and something that I know is pretty excited, which Avi wrote down for me from the ESO Live, which we'll talk about later, but you'll have to stay and wait for that. And Clan of Orphan says, yes, we are getting old. We're 97 episodes in. We're getting there. We're definitely getting there. Let's see. The Gamer Shiznap. I gotta say welcome to all the people in chat room as well. So sorry for all you guys are in there. Is there a level group in the guild? Unfortunately, I don't believe there is. No, I don't think there is, which is sad.
No, I mean, it's not, but I mean, if a couple of people join and they're like VR 3 or 4, I'm sure that wouldn't be a problem to do, like, easiest trials. So.
No, not at all. We can carry people. All right, well, before we really get rolling, we got to first off say thank you to all of our supporters, including our newest Patreon supporter, Jamie Worth. Thank you so much, Jamie, for supporting us, as well as everyone else on there that has been supporting us month to month. Terry, Cameron, Carly, CSF, Farragon, thank you. Single Malt, Fishmaker, Stephanie, Sean, Michael, Adam, and Kilted Piper. I wanted to say that because I haven't been mentioning the people who have been supporting us month after month after month, and I really need to start doing that, so I'm going to start making sure I mention everybody. As time allows, of course. So thank you so much for all you guys who are currently supporting us. You guys are the best. If you're currently not supporting the Dungeon Crawler Network and wish to help us out, you can do so by heading over to our website, dungeoncrawlernetwork.com, clicking on the link for Patreon and signing up there. There's some rewards there that are kind of interesting, such as one of the things I started adding is whenever I'm streaming, I've created a Patreon-only channel that I will be in. As soon as I can figure out some weird DNS issues that keep kicking me out, it's really stupid. That while I'm streaming, you can interact with me in TeamSpeak, not just in chat. So you can really give me a hard time there too. So, and a few other rewards that you'll see if you look through the rewards for the people who support us every month. So thank you so much. All right, guys, we're going to roll right on into the game news. There was a little bit. First off, this was from ESO Live. Thank you again to Avi, who was kind enough to this morning receive a text from me going, I'm not going to have time to do this. Can you listen to it? And he did. But this is a nice PSA. People are now getting emails claiming that they won the $1 million from ZOS, but those are all spam because the one winner has already been reached, and I'm sure they've already been talking to them, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. So if you get an email now saying that you were the winner of the... I gotta reach my drink. It's so close. The million reasons to play, you are probably not because they've already talked to them. So you are not one of those winners. Sorry. But just
I didn't win, so rigged.
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 Here's the thing that I was thinking of, conspiracy theory type thing. I remember, one of the personalities, Deltia actually, won one of the giveaways during ESO Live, and you should have seen chat. Like everyone was screaming, the whole thing was rigged. Like, he just, I forget what he won. It was like a t-shirt or something. It doesn't really matter. It was just, you know, he typed in the thing and he won. I was just thinking about that. If any of us had won, as a company, like, I wouldn't announce it. Because could you imagine if it was one of the personalities who won, one of us who do something, the amount of people would be screaming it's rigged.
Hey, man, I need $10,000 to pay my credit card. Can I borrow that? You know?
Spamming emails to us. So, how about passing some of that on?
Yeah. So, I just wanted to give that little PSA again. Thank you to Avi who got this news for me because it was a heart's day, as you can see. I've been kissed up. And I was out and about and I did not get any time on Friday when they aired. I normally watch it when I was at work, but I was unable to, so I missed it. All right, first off on the news, on the live servers, we got a new patch 2.2.11, an incremental patch that addressed a couple issues with the Orsinium DLC pack, Camouflage Hunter, which is starting to very quickly become a focus charge, you know, in my mind, the amount of times they save they fix this thing, and to include additional improvements to Cyrodiil. So the patch is probably about 150 megs. They fixed Arena 9, Theater of Despair, fixed an issue where Lava's Molten Destruction ability, targeting anyone outside of the intended range after used a Way Shrine to the lobby, and then later re-entered the arena. So they fixed that issue. They fixed an issue with fishing in Hrothgar, which was causing multiple instances of fish to spawn on top of each other, so it looked like you're fishing out of one pool, but in reality there were like 100 pools there, so you're fishing out of all of them, and allowed people to catch multiple fish per cast. That is now fixed. there was a quest for one of the NPCs in a Scholar's Hostel, as well as Fighter's Guild Camouflage Hunter, the Expert Hunter Morph, fixed an ability where this could proc multiple times with the dual-wield heavy attack. So that has supposedly been fixed. Has anyone been running Camouflaged Hunter?
Not me.
No?
I was always an Evil Hunter guy myself.
Yeah, Evil Hunter.
I know camo's bugged and handy and all, but... Yeah.
It's really only useful in PvP. Because... how the whole thing procs is when you go into stealth, unless you're a Nightblade, and take that back, because you can have abilities that can put you into stealth, but unless you're a Nightblade, you're only going to get one chance to go out of stealth, and that's like your first attack if you're lucky, right? So I don't find it being all that useful unless you are a Nightblade, in which case, Nightblades rock on, I guess. So anything else from anyone else before we move on to the next thing? It was kind of a small patch, but they fixed a few things.
The no, focus charge.
I was just going to say, they said it on ESO Live. They're like, so you know how we have focus charged on the patch. Just so you know, it's not fixed. we've just fixed parts of it.
Ah.
Can somebody explain to me what focus charged is? Because all I hear is people just make fun of that ability because it's so broken.
It's from the Aedric Spear line on Templars. It's the charge ability, the one where they jump in the air with the spear and then...
Yeah. Why the hell is it so broken?
Because you get stuck in the animation constantly. So, like, while you're jumping, you're like, yeah! And then you're sitting there holding the spear and you can't do any abilities. You're just like...
Oh, that's awesome.
Screw it.
Yeah.
So the running joke is this has been broken since beta. Like, it's literally never been working as intended. You'd always get stuck. And every few patches are like, we fixed focus charge. No, you still get stuck. So
yeah, it's a joke that wore thin a long time ago that they fix it.
Yeah.
They're like teasing us.
Yeah, every time.
It's fixed. No, it's not.
No. No. I actually started using it earlier, and then I switched it back out because I got stuck. I was like, I changed my build up a bit away from the best in slot DPS to be a little bit more focused on, or not a little bit more, a little bit more well rounded all the way. So I added heals, I've added a closer, you know, as well as keeping my other DPS abilities. So I have like my main ones, like my biting jabs and things like that, and my execute. So like my two main abilities. Right there, which is 90% of my DPS anyway, as long as I weave right and keep my other things up. But instead of running the quote-unquote best-in-slot build, I removed some of those excess abilities such as Repentance, and I added in extra heals and the charge so I can run around quicker because I just needed it. So... I'm a little bit more well-rounded, but I'm like, well, I need a charge. Well, I have a two-hander. That's perfect. And I'm like, well, do I really want to waste all this stamina? Because it hits like a truck, but it does cost stamina, and that's my main resource. I'm like, well, I don't ever use Magicka, so why don't I just use the Magicka ones? I threw it on there, because all I'm using it for is a gap closer. What do I care? Yeah, it's broken. So I switched it. Having stamina is wonderful, but if you can't actually activate any of your abilities because you're stuck in the spear-holding animation, it doesn't really matter anyway.
Especially if you're doing Maelstrom.
Yeah,
yeah. Oh, my goodness.
I've been doing a lot of Maelstrom lately. Like, a
Have
lot.
You?
But I've been doing it on low-level characters because in one run, now given this is only, like, low-level, like 40, I gained 3 levels in Maelstrom Arena just from one run. Like, one... full run, 3 levels.
Man, that's
now,
really good.
Now, I did use one of those leftover scrolls, but even so, that's still really good. So in like an hour and a half, I got 3 levels out of it. So I went from like 43 to 46. I thought that was amazing. So I went to do it again, and I couldn't do it again. But anyway. All right, next little bit of news coming from us from the PTS itself. Patch 2.3.1 hit, so they added another patch to the PTS if you haven't been around, which was the first incremental patch to the PTS that addressed a couple of issues with Thieves Guild and the Maul of Lorkhaj trial, plus several other Orsinium and Imperial City DLC packs as well. They've made a number of adjustments to combat, gameplay, itemization, UI, and so forth and so forth. They also added in the 64-bit client, which, Crabby, have you got a chance to download that on the PTS?
No, I can't. I can't because I have ESO on my SSD.
Okay.
And I don't have enough space, so if I download the game again, I can't. I don't have space for it. So I actually just can't do it.
Yeah, yeah. I understand. Yes, Josh, the Maelstrom Arena, I was amazed. I heard another streamer say how good it is, and I kind of was like half believing him, but I went in anyway, and I did gain like 3 levels in there. You're supposedly able to do it more than once, but I feel like it's a daily quest, so you can like only get the quest once a day. Avi, do you know if that's correct? And I know you were working on it a few times.
No, I'm not positive at all, actually.
I know. It's normally because by the time I'm done with it once, I'm like, okay, I'm going to walk away.
I can't imagine doing it 2 times in one day. So.
Yeah, I think you can only do the full thing once a day. I mean, you can do once on normal, once on vet, but vet, it's really tough. So it might be a little bit more advantageous to move on to something else. But normal... for leveling, it'll do it once you get a couple levels out of it. It was worth it to me. All right, so other than the new features and updates they added, of course, the 64-bit client is now available for the PTS. You'll need to manually launch it, so keep that in mind. You'll have to launch the ESO64.exe from your PTS install directory. So if you want to try it out, make sure you do that. It's not going to be a simple, you know, just clicking the play button. You actually have to manually launch it, so keep that in mind. When the Thieves Guild does go live, they said they were going to update the launcher, so the correct version will be launched automatically, thank goodness. I'm looking forward to the 64-bit. Like I really am. I'm excited. Anyone else?
Yeah, I mean, it should help with crashing and other, like, maybe super long load times, maybe a little bit. Like, I don't know. I mean, it should help a bit.
Right. Okay. I know Avi's working towards his new PC, so he'll probably appreciate that once he gets that in place.
Yeah, yeah. I'll appreciate it in a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. I don't know anyone who still uses a Mac for anything other than graphic designs, but they have improved facial animations are now enabled for Mac clients with this patch on the PTS, so enjoy that. They've updated the way Thieves Guild reputation has been calculated for this patch. So if you previously had reputation with the Thieves Guild on an existing character, your actual rank may not be accurately reflected within the guild, which could prevent you from ranking up further. So they changed the way of actually gaining experience in those skill lines. I didn't get a chance to really hop in and figure out, I mean, other than going in and stealing stuff, but I'm sure they probably did something with the back-end algorithm, changed it up. Maybe it was too fast, too slow. Who knows? But they changed that. The Cyrodiil Rare Item Merchant. I'm not going to read it, but it's a Khajiit. So don't get too excited, Avi. Don't get too excited.
Okay.
All right. Yeah, but this Khajiit merchant, the Golden, as he's called, will now only appear on weekends. She will arrive. Ooh, it's a she too, Avi.
Ooh. Man, time to start playing.
Ready for some Hearts Day? All right.
She's only a she on weekends.
Yeah. Every other day of the week, it's a dude.
Yeah. So, gotta show it when you can.
That vendor needs to go, by the way.
Yeah.
Like, why does that vendor exist?
Not a fan of it, huh?
No, like, why even do White Gold Tower, or is it White Gold Tower prisons for the helmet?
There's one for each.
Okay, yeah, why even bother doing them if you can just spend 200,000 on both pieces? You know, it's like, and that's not a whole lot of gold, I mean.
Yeah, like we talked about last time, the main issue is that it's not a lot of gold.
Yeah.
It's not a lot of gold and not really a lot of AP either. Now, with this being said, this merchant is my big thing that was for this was when you bought it, it was automatically a Divine's trait, which I was not very pleased with because it's Divine's trait. It's like the best one ever. And chat room, if you guys have any thoughts about this merchant, please speak up. I'd love to hear your thoughts as well, but I see there's some active people in the chat room. I just want to make sure they're actively talking about this merchant as well. If it's permanently bought, it's like 200,000 AP and I believe 100,000 gold. So you need both. I think it's
both. Oh, you need both?
You need both, yes.
I thought you only needed...
No, it's both.
90-something thousand gold.
No, it's both.
Oh, good. So it's at least both. That's
okay. Well,
unless they changed it from the last time, it was both. Like, you needed both. And I get the idea for this. I understand why they're doing this. They were doing it for PvP because really, I'm in the same boat. I don't want a PvP to get abilities that help me in PvE like Caltrops and Vigor, but I need to, and it's a pain for me because I don't want to be in PvP. I don't care. But I have to do it in order to get these abilities. It's sort of vice versa with these people who are like, I don't want to do PvE. I don't give a crap about the dungeons. I just want to play PvP. You know, they're trying to add a little bit of accessibility in there for the people trying to do it. Now, I know Asteldian will probably argue with me about accessibility in modern games, but that might be for another show.
no complaints at all. I understand why they put this in. I've actually got no problem. I think the pricing's a bit off. Because even for PvE, as you have to do PvP for those various skills, well, they have just knocked down the requirements to need those skills quite considerably, or are doing so with the next DLC.
Oh,
so,
thank heaven.
I mean, yeah, if you, so, if so they've you, already done that. So they've bought it in so that the PvPers can actually get some helmets without boring themselves to death running dungeon after dungeon, which they probably really
and
hate.
And not only that, but some of the dungeons, such as Imperial City Prison and Imperial City White Gold Tower, you need to be pretty top end. And PvP builds are different from PvE builds. They're not set on, you know, min-maxing. They're set for... Now, I should say, they're not set for min-maxing in a certain regard. They're not set the way PvEers are. Like, PvEers are, like, especially for DPS, the lowest bare minimum health because you're trying to squeeze out as much damage. Because if you're doing it right, you're not taking damage anyway. You only need enough health to survive the attacks that are unavoidable. So you have the lowest amount of health, highest amount of the resources, and that's how you try to build these extra damage. You have very specific builds you run, whereas PvP, it's more about lockdown stuns. You have these abilities that you would never have on PvE, because why would you have crowd control abilities in PvE other than trash? Because bosses, 90% are immune to them. So it's like, oh, I have a knockdown. You throw it, immune. Oh, well, that was worthless.
Yeah, and that's actually a good point, because obviously I know PvEers will say, well, we have to suffer through PvP to get skills. Well, I'd say there's a difference. As a PvEer, you can freeload your way to get the AP points. At the end of the day, you join the biggest, baddest crew and just loiter. Whereas a PvPer, if they want to be running the dungeons efficiently or mm-hmm. even at all with the group, they need to suddenly change their whole builds, make a whole new set of gear.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's a lot of work. You know, you can't just turn up and expect to do the White Gold Tower successfully. So there was a big difference there. So I'm glad the helmets are appearing. It's just they need to be more expensive. AP-wise, more than gold, because, as I say, PvPers tend not to have much gold, but they have loads of AP.
I'm reading on the patch notes for 2.3, mm-hmm. and it says they'll sell for a high amount of AP or gold.
Yeah, it's one or the other. Here, I have it right here.
Then I went to 2.3.1, and it only mentioned the weekend thing.
Yeah. Well, this cat is driving me nuts. Get out of here. She's Dominion, and she's driving me crazy. Stop it!
Yeah, I have a picture of it right here, and it has, like, the same arm crop, two of them. You can either buy it for 900 or 99,000 or 200,000 alliance points.
I'm going to open it.
Yeah, I don't... Yeah.
See, at that point, I think they've ruined the whole reason for having... this whole thing. It is specifically for, yeah, and even 99,000, that's not a lot of gold.
That's what I'm saying. No. There's no reason to do like the White Gold Tower ones if you're gonna go for like Molag Kina or whatever.
Yeah, and I mean, at least the shoulders wise of things, they come out of the daily chest. I mean, it's a rarity. I can see that, but the helms, for instance, well, I don't know, it all depends. It's 100,000 gold. I think that all needs jacked up, like the price. Well, and that's why it's on the PTS. You know, they're gonna look at this and go, well, you know, 200,000, that's not a lot. I mean, my goodness, the recipes for the Akaviri set are more expensive. Like, and especially if it's something that has the perfect trait on it, mind you, perfect trait on it. The helms I'm a little different on, because the shoulders come out of the bag, so it's all RNG based, right? It's like, oh, did I get it? No. But at least the helms, you could literally farm it in a day. Like, you may not get it, but you can run it as many times as you want. Justin in chat says, I ran the White Gold Tower last night with the group finder tool. We did perfectly fine, just saying. Did you do it on VR16 Vet? Because I'd be a little surprised. I mean, not calling into effect you and your skills. I'm calling it the fact that you managed to get three other people on par for veteran White Gold Tower. The normal one's easy enough. I mean, Avi and Ark and I three-manned it, but the vet is not a pushover. So
it's really hard.
Yeah. I don't know. I feel like, especially AP, especially with some of the people really hardcore PvP, and I know some of our PvP listeners, if you're listening, you'd be like, why are you taking it away from us? Honestly, if you think about it, man, just if you're honest with yourself, how much AP do you really get at a time if this is what you do all the time? I'm sure you've maximized it and go, yeah, it is pretty easy to get that. You know, like, I'm sitting here looking at 200k AP going, oh my goodness, I don't know if I'll ever get it. I think my lifetime AP score is under 100 or under 100,000 total, but There's some people do that in, you know, like a weekend or less.
Should be 500,000 at least.
Yeah.
Because the idea of it, as I say, is for the PvP is, that's not going to put them off. PvE is, I don't think, do I really want 500,000's worth of AP? That's a lot of work. They'd probably rather farm the dungeon. Of course, they're selling for gold anyway, so that's made it really pointless.
Either way, it's I can farm gold or I can do either. The one thing that's supposed to happen with this, though, are you're only supposed to see one on the merchant a week. One a week. And if it was a random trait, I wouldn't feel so bad. You know what I mean? But if it's divines every time, it's like, wow, well, maybe, I don't know. I guess it all depends on, you get 7 chances a week in order to get, you actually would get more. You could get up to 14 chances, even though it's less in the silver bag to get the pieces. But you could get the shoulders, essentially 14 tries a week. So, I don't know. It is the permanent chance of getting a divine trait, which is the best in the game right now, really, really worth it. Clan of War says, the battle that rages in every game between PvP and PvE, both say the company only cares about the other. I'm not really arguing. I don't think it's a bad thing that it's here. I'm more arguing the fact that it's a perfect trait and
too cheap.
I don't mind
more on the PvE side as well. It's just too easy. 100,000 is nothing for PvE to afford.
Oh yeah, my goodness, I'm sitting on 300,000 right now, and I didn't even work hard for it. And I blew half my money earlier. I was sitting at over, and I would be considered one of the poorer PvEers. I know people with way more money. I had over like almost 2 million at one point, and that's kind of low for a lot of people in PvE. So. No, it's not the fact that it's there or that we're against it. We get the idea of why they're doing it. They're doing it for PvPers who don't want to waste their time in dungeons. That's wonderful. But it's just too cheap, especially for a perfect trait. Like, you can literally go, oh, I need a Mole Kenna medium shoulder with divines. Buy it. It's too easy. Just too easy. That's the thing we're complaining about. Not that it's there. It's just too easy. Kind of funny, but on the PTS, that under the known issues, the slash bug command is still not working.
I mean, you don't need the bug command to work on the PTS.
I mean, of all things, I think that would probably be my one priority, like on your checklist before you send it out, like, does the bug command work?
Can players properly report issues with the game? No, okay, well, you know, we don't really, you know, whatever.
Now, they did point us to a new thread.
Just message us on Twitter.
I actually see people doing that, too.
I see it all over Twitter right now.
There were some people who were, like, messaging Gina on her personal Twitter, and I'm just sitting there shaking my head. They're, like, messaging, like, she's wrote a personal message, something personal, and then they're, like, taking pictures. Like, can you please respond to this? And I'm like, she's talking about her dog in real life. Like, why would you go, why is ESO broken? It's like, why are you even bothering following?
Just get everyone to email IGN. They'll be quick to make sure everyone knows if any bugs are around.
Oh, IGN. Okay. Well, they do have a thread. So if you're on the forums or if you're on the PTS and you're having issues submitting bug reports, you have to go to the forums to do it. There's a thread for that. The Moondancer Sword and Maul of Lorcaj. When I first read this, the first thing I thought it was Avi. I was thinking it was the Sword Sweller, but no, it's not. It does not have the proper visuals. But that's the first thing I was going to highlight it, and I was going to send it to you, and then I'm like, oh wait, that's a different mob. Never mind.
This has become a continuing joke, hasn't it?
It really has. I mean, this is your thing now, so. Yeah. I mean, we got hashtag blame Crabby. Sword swallowing for you. I mean, we'll figure something out for everybody.
Hey, they made the Khajiits pretty in this game, so.
This is true. My wife loves Irki from the Cold Harbor, the Meridius city in Cold Harbor. There is a Khajiit called Irki there who is hilarious if you talk to her because she's in love with another female Dunmer. And, the conversation's hilarious. Like, the Dunmer's like, I have a problem with this Khajiit merchant over here. She keeps leaving dead skeevers on my porch. And you go and talk to her, and she's like, I don't get it. I can't even think about my work. All I think about is rubbing up against the dark elf's shapely leg. And I've tried everything. I mean, leaving dead skeevers on her porch to show that I like her. It's just hilarious. It cracked me up. Yeah. Ooh. Dungeons and group content. The White Gold Tower. Otho, Micella, and Cordius. Those are the three Dragon Knights. No longer have the ability to critically hit player characters.
Oh, okay.
That's a good thing, because
nice.
Those guys are not easy. And there's some other things in here. I was looking through it, see if there's other things in here. But most of it's art and animation, a few other minor fixes. So you can go check that out on the official Elder Scrolls Online forums. Alrighty, it's time for ESO Live, because that is what we're talking about now. I was reading chat, and all I saw was the people complaining about PvP, spamming no ETA. Oh my goodness, that's awful. Yeah. All right, so first off, on ESO Live, a couple things that were talked about. They're working on magic stamina ability changes for Dark Brotherhood.
Why do they wait? I need to butt right in your face right
okay,
here.
All
right,
go ahead.
Why do they wait for a major patch to go over stamina or magic abilities? Because stamina's not getting touched.
They said their main focus was the all around class, so they focused on the all around sorcerer. But yeah. Technically, I guess that didn't mean like their morphs and all the extra stuff. So they said they're gonna focus a lot more on stamina when it comes to the Dark Brotherhood
and magic too. Weird. You know, like I don't know.
Hey, I'm a stamina user, so
I feel like they should like. They shouldn't dump everything into a DLC release, you know? Like, the base game patch should come out in pieces up until the next DLC. That's kind of how I feel about it.
With their incremental patches, I don't know if there's a reason why they handle the patches the way that they handle patches at this point. But they tend to save any type of changes for DLC patches, and it makes sense because they don't have a constantly running PTS. They only bring the PTS up to test, so for incremental patches, they're not going to throw out these updates constantly.
I get that, but like, I don't know, even some bug fixes, I feel like, shouldn't be held back for the big patch, too.
Bug fixes, they're pretty quick on, and Clan of Orphan, I agree, ESO chat, it's just so bad. The ESO live chat, when they do those, it's gotten so bad lately. It's so hard to watch.
Well, it's so bad because there's like so many people watching it now.
It's awful. Main focus for Thieves Guild was all around class changes when it came to abilities. So, working on magic of stamina ability changes. Are you thinking here when they talk about this, Avi, I'm kind of curious because you wrote this note on the pretext of this. Do you think they're talking about the stamina magicka morphs?
Yeah, that's exactly what they're talking about.
Oh, thank heaven.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know some people were not very happy with one of my comments before about wishing that all class abilities had either a magicka or stamina morph. Are that the class abilities would use whichever resource was highest. But I do. And
I agree. It should be that way.
I mean, some people are like, well, it's all about choice. And I respect their arguments. They can make their arguments. But I'm like, when you're limited to 5 bars, you can make everything main resource and go from there. It's just some skills are more attractive than others, and if you're playing a certain type of playstyle, you don't have access to them because they just don't work. And Justin agrees with you, Crabby, that they need to get more of these essential changes out before big patches, if it's at all reasonable. Mm-hmm. I think the biggest thing is no one cares to jump on their PT. I think they have a hard enough time getting people on their PTS when there is a big patch. How are you going to get people on a PTS to test a random bug fix? I think they have a very low usage case for their PTS. I don't think that they get a lot of active hits on it. Hence why they're talking about Cyrodiil changes. When they make those, they have to make them on live servers because they can't reproduce anything near what is on live servers on the PTS, even during big patches. I mean, I was on the PTS last night just messing around, and you know, I have a fully maxed out friends list of people who play on the US server, and I was thinking, well, I'm prime time. I saw like two people. That was it. So it makes me wonder, you know, like I out of all the people, and then I log on to the live server and there's 30 people on, you know, on my friends list. It's like, okay.
All right, Mr. Popular. All right. We get it.
Yeah. Check him out.
I actually have to delete people off my friends list. If you haven't been on the game for a while, you often get deleted off because I have to make room.
Just keep on rubbing it in.
You're so friend needy.
I'm friend needy.
One guy hey, once, you're like, oh, you're my friend now.
Asteldian, come on. We're all about MMOs and the social aspect here. So I need a bigger friends list. Maybe they'll sell it to me in the Crown Store.
My friends list is always tiny, but then I rely on my wife's friends list to keep track of everyone we know or met.
So you have two friends lists, technically.
Yeah, mine's empty. She keeps them all. If they're really, really worthy, they might get on both lists.
Is that why I'm not on your friends list? That's awful.
Might be.
he's a bad. Yeah. Project 99, I signed on. He's like, nope, I'm not here. Slashing on. Don't talk to him. He's terrible. Actually, I pretty much am.
You are. You're never on.
Never on. I'm like a level 3. I keep dying and losing all the gear. It's awful. Because I keep forgetting to do the slash lock command. When I die, I res. Oh, yeah, lock. And it tells me where I'm standing at that exact time. And I'm like, oh, well, that didn't work. Alright, they're also working on werewolf and vampire changes for Dark Brotherhood, so we're going to see some more of those.
To be useful again.
Yeah, changes to their abilities in specific, so it should be interesting to see if they make them a little more decent.
I think they're useful for what they are. I like the most recent changes where they changed how they were, that it wasn't you needed to have one of these. It was, if you were Magicka, like, two patches ago, you had to be Vampire. If you were Stamina, you had to be Werewolf. Like, there was no, you could choose to be neither. I like the fact, the way they changed them, that there is, recourse for having these skills. Like, oh, maybe you don't want them because of all the negatives. Like, they have a lot of really overwhelming positives. That's awesome. But they need to have a corresponding negative to make people go, do I really want this? I really think there needs to be some more hard counters for vampires and stuff like that. Such as what I would love to see, and this PvPers would hate me. Fighters Guild abilities. Such as like the knockdowns and stuff work on vampires and werewolves, even if they pop the potion that makes them immune because of werewolf and vampire. There needs to be hard counters against it because they are so powerful. But anyway, that's me. Justin says, I finally cured my vamp. Yeah, they need reasons. All right. Weapon ultimates are in discussion. I know we talked about that before, about weapon ultimate abilities.
Oh man, I feel like the Destro staff staves would be awesome. Like just something big and crazy happening with those ultimates.
Right.
I'm sure all the staves would be ridiculously awesome.
I know. I know, you read my mind. what would be the what would be the, like, ultimate for, like, a one-handed mace? Well, I guess that would be sword and shield, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Or like a big old two-hander slash or something. I can't even think.
Like some sort of like spinning thing or something. I don't know.
They just need to kick them behind the knees. Like it just needs to be like you kick them behind the knees, they fall down to their knees, and you behead them. That's
that
the
two-handed. I would go two-handed for that.
sounds like Witcher 3.
Exactly. Kick them behind the knees, they fall over, you chop their head off.
And then you sleep with all the prostitutes. It is exactly like The Witcher 3, the best ultimate.
Well, yeah, it's Davin's Watch. There's that one inn in Davin's Watch you can go into, and all the Dunmer chicks. Are... And then you talk to the one Nord, he's like, get out of my way, you're blocking the view. And honestly, you were.
that's where my character hangs out all the time.
I thought it was Abba's Landing.
That's the new place. That's only on PTS.
That's only on PTS. Man, that sword swallowing Argodian. I better not let the East see this, or she's going to be all over him. She already has a love affair with the real buff Argonian in... it's a town in Deshaun. I can't remember it now. But the first town you come across, there's a big buff Argonian. Rodrigo and Obi, welcome to the chat room, guys. lots of love there, Jealous. Yeah, I see. It's hard stay. It's hard stay in Tamriel, so yeah. Yes, my wife was taking pictures of the little milk drinker, and she put on lipstick so she could kiss him, and then when I walked up there to get a drink, she's like, oh, no, you're not getting away, and she kissed me too. So, hard stay. All right. No big racial passives changes will be coming until after they release the barbershop, and I understand the reasoning for this. They didn't want anyone to play a Nord and realize that Nord racials suck, and then not have a way of changing out of it.
That actually makes sense why they're not changing it till the barbershop, though. I get that.
Zakir, except welcome in chat.
They're playing their class or their race that sucks, and they're just waiting for you to change it.
I'm not gonna change because you know Dunmer master race, but you know whatever.
I will be a Nord forever. I don't care. I know it sucks, but I don't care. I like him. Plus, he has that, you know, 6% damage reduction, so I can be stupid 6% longer than other people.
Hey, that might change. You ready?
Don't remove that. Then I'm just sucky all the time.
Wow.
Yeah. So it makes sense why they're doing that. Cross-faction trials are being worked on and currently being tested.
Yes.
Thank you, sweet, not-yet-born baby Talos. Because that was a big thing for us, and I know...
Yeah, two Fridays ago when we did the first trial night, we actually had a couple people saying, oh man, I don't have a high enough level on EP, I'm DC or AD or whatever, you know, and that would have solved a lot of problems.
Oh yeah, it definitely would, especially for this PvE-related stuff. It would absolutely solve a lot of problems. I don't see why they don't let us do it all the time. I really think they should, and I'm glad that they're working towards this. I know, Avi, you have characters who you would like to bring out of retirement for this stuff.
Yeah, I got 3 or 4 DC VR tunes.
I mean, I've only played the good faction, so I'm pretty much set. But
bag on this one, you know, it's, yeah.
Yeah, Ebonheart Pack, Blood for the Pack. See, I'm even wearing a Blood for the Pack shirt right now. So.
Where'd you get that?
From the store.
They sell big and tall fat guy sizes? Because I need to check that.
I think they sell XL. I think that's all sell.
That's not big enough.
I'm actually going to pull it up for you right now just because I'm really curious. Because that was something I was looking at. And they have a Fallout hoodie. Ooh. Man, see, this is where I waste all my money.
I have way too much Fallout stuff already in this damn room.
Yeah.
That little guy is everywhere. I even have a bobblehead.
Well, I bought this when they had a sale where it was like 50% off, so like $10. So I bought like 2 t-shirts. I got the Ouroboros. Actually, I might be wrong. Apparel size goes from small to 6XL.
Oh. Yeah. So.
Yeah, there's small,
medium,
large. I mean,
I'm not like obese, but 3XL is comfortable for me.
Yeah, they come in XL, XXL, 3XL, 4XL, 5XL, and 6XL. At least in the Ouroboros t-shirt, this one in particular. Let me see here.
Jesus, 6XL, what's that, a tent?
I don't want to hear any of your crap, all right?
I actually have a red one,
I was shoveling pretzels into my mouth.
Certain shirts come up to that. It looks like I have a red Evan Hart pack hoodie, too. You'll have to go in between it, but the Evan Hart pack Heritage t-shirt only goes up to a double XL, XXL, whatever.
That's pretty good, Avi. I don't think it fits.
It doesn't fit him.
But the Ouroboros t-shirt, which is one I normally wear for the show, it comes up to 6XL. So you'll have to look at the individual t-shirts. They come in varying sizes. Like the Father of Cold Harbor t-shirt that I'm looking at right now, the Molag Ball, has a low supply of 3XL, but that's as high as it goes. So, I mean, you can check. So the store hat, if you look at one shirt and it doesn't have your size, check the others because they may. So it looks like they have varying sizes depending on the popularity of the shirt, I guess. So, Dova boy. Oh, my. Yeah, 6XL is kind of crazy. So they did reconfirm that veteran ranks are leaving with the Dark Brotherhood. I feel like they have to confirm that every show.
This time the guy was like, yeah. It's actually in the next build or whatever.
The development build that they're using? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, that's good. I'm kind of curious to see how that's going to work on. They're changing some of the damage types for classes to work with champion skill trees. And this is something that Hero of None, who, if you don't follow on Twitter, you should. He was making a post about, on the forums, how people just ripped Eric Roble apart for this one, and I'll get into why, but one of the things they're doing is they're changing one of the Dragon Knight stamina morphs to now use poison damage instead of fire damage. I think it's the fire whip. So it works with the mighty passive of the champion system, so that way you don't need to split between magic and stamina to get the buffs for the fire damage, because as you know, most of the Dragon Knight passives affect fire damage. Well, fire damage is magic, so if you're not going with Thermitage in the champion tree, you're not getting the most out of it. You need to go with Mighty. Mighty is the physical damage. Well, poison, I guess, calculates under physical instead of magic. I'm not really sure why. But people were really upset about this one because of they're like, well, now you're changing how my build's going to work. Now I'm not going to be, why do I even have these passives anymore? But I understand why they're trying to do it, because if you're stamina, you need to go more the physical champion point way, not the magic way. But people were very upset about this one.
Well, yeah, the passive's like, what, Kindling, where it increases fire dot damage. Wouldn't that affect it? Well,
it would. It would in fire damage. It would. However, that passive also gets further buffed through the champion point tree Thermitage, which affects elemental damage. Elemental damage, however, is not affected by Mighty, which is physical damage. So a lot of your other abilities, such as all the abilities from Two-Hander, like your raw damage from your light and heavy attacks, is affected by Mighty, not these other passives. So Dragon Knights were in a weird situation, which they were still so much more OP than every other class, even when they had to split, so I don't understand how that works. But anyway, people would have to split between Mighty, which was physical damage, and Thermitage. It's still in the same tree, which helps you get the passives you need, the milestone passives, but you had to split it. Whereas I'm walking around with an extra, 25, 30, or whatever it is. Actually, I guess it's like 15% extra damage. They're walking around with 9 in each. So that they could have the proper skills affected. Tried to split it between the two. What was the true change with poison damage? I thought it was meant that it is a possibility. It is. This is something they were talking about trying to do to try to make it a little bit more effective. But it's just the amount of people that ripped into it. And it's like, guys, we're just trying this to see if this works. And it kind of tore into it. Thoughts, anyone?
There was a stamina morph they were talking about, the fire whip, changing it.
Yeah, that's what they're talking about here.
Well,
now it's going to be poison whip.
It's poison whip.
Thought is to change things. I wrote about earlier about having more stamina morphs. I don't understand why you've not got two magicka and two stamina morphs for each skill.
Mm-hmm.
Or at the very least, keep the original two magicka and then just add an extra one in for a stamina skill. And then you've got the problem solved, haven't you? If you're a guy who's not going to want the fire, you just go, oh, I'll pick the stamina morph that makes it poison. Someone else might want to stick with the stamina morph that still does fire. He can do that too.
Well, that's where if you made all your class abilities scale, like they've done it with so many other things, other abilities that determine based on whatever your highest stat is, you know, what it affects, why would you not? You know, like, it's one of those things where the class abilities, if they just change it so that all the class abilities used whatever your highest resource was, it just worked out that way. I mean, I guess if you wanted to go, that would effectively kill hybrid builds.
Well, there's so many passives that are based on your magicka damage or stamina ability. Magicka abilities or stamina abilities, how would it know what is what?
Well, they've done it already.
Hybrid builds mean dead forever.
They tried to add it with Imperial City with those the prismatic enchants that did all three. But
only tanks used them.
Yeah. And honestly, I think tanks would probably prefer to go the higher stamina. The only reason why they went with some magic abilities is because there wasn't a good stamina morph, and they were just really good abilities. And you needed stamina for blocking, but if they went the full stamina morph, tanks would probably love loading up on health and stamina rather than having to split some magicka as well. At least that's my thoughts anyway.
Well, the magic gave you a lot of options with your stamina anyway. Like a DK would use his magic to replenish his stamina because every time he casts an earthen ability, he'd gain some more stamina back.
Right.
So.
Well, yeah, that's one of those things we talked about a long time ago, the ability to add in, what was it, way back early when stamina was really bad. One of the reasons was it was because of sustain issues. And we're like, why don't we have like a Fighter's Guild ability that allows us to, you know, sacrifice magicka for stamina like, you know, the Mage's Guild does. It has the I don't know if it does stamina, I think it's health. But you eat one to gain another. The balance skill. We talked about that a long time ago, like episode 40. some things like that. And they made a lot of strides to make both fun, but magicka still has a lot of abilities that stamina just doesn't have. In terms of sustain, even though it got nerfed to all Oblivion, I liked using Oblivion. I didn't even mean it as an Elder Scrolls reference. It just worked out that way. That magicka has a much higher survive from what I see because of all the native restores through health. Like you can use heal abilities and things like that. Just keep going.
As a side note, did you see how hard they buffed Wall of Elements?
That's because no one used it.
They made it like super overpowered, though.
That's the only way anyone would ever use it.
I was watching, I think Deltia was like messing around with it. He was like, holy crap, this does so much damage now. I was like, oh my god.
Well, it's kind of like the Maelstrom Arena Destruction Staff, okay? You know how each one, the Veteran Arena affected the first skill?
Yeah.
Now, the second one affected the second skill, which would be wonderful if they buffed up that DSA to make it so that, you know, you could get any of the ability. It would be great that you could pick the weapon, that VR-16 that worked with your build. But anyway, that's beside the point. It was funny that everyone who got the Destruction Staff is like, well, this is practically worthless because who's ever going to use Wall of Elements?
Yeah, they probably destroyed it by now. They'll be kicking themselves now.
Yeah, right? Yeah, they had VR-16. I'll just break that. Who cares? I'm not going to ever use it. And now they're hating themselves. Yeah. Final little bit of note from ESO Live before we move on to our Tales section is Brad Derrick, audio lead, said that they want to work with more bard music in the game. So, yes, everyone will be able to have a personal bard follow them around and sing Red Diamond.
Oh, good.
I can have Maluka follow me around.
Yeah, they would do. They do want to work on Maluka.
Is that creepy? You know?
It is. Well, it is.
Whatever. Only if you try and give her swords to imitate a certain Argonian.
You just gotta go, you know.
We love you, Maluka.
We do love Maluka. We really do. So they would like to work with her again, but it says it won't happen until a DLC without a big zone, and possibly the one after Dark Brotherhood, meaning small or no zone for third quarter, maybe. Who knows?
Which means Dark Brotherhood is going to introduce housing?
No.
I think that's coming at the end of the year.
Might be Q3 or Q4. Yeah, no, Dark Brotherhood is not going to announce... They're not bringing housing with Dark Brotherhood. Dark Brotherhood is by itself. And that's another thing. I got a bone to pick with Krabby on this one.
Let's go.
He sent me a Twitter message with a highlight showing that they've confirmed housing. And Avi,
confirmed it for 2016.
Yeah, but we've been saying that.
No.
Avi, have we not said that?
No. Krabby doesn't watch Tales of Tamriel.
I
listen to it kind of at work, all right?
Kind of at work. Okay. Because I'm pretty sure we've said that multiple times.
No. Nope.
Can we kick this guy off the call?
I think we can.
No, he said it for this year, and I was like, oh my God.
I know, and what was my response? I'm like, yeah, we've been saying that.
Response was, I'm a big jerk. And I told
you. I'm too busy to talk to you. I'm hanging out with Argonians who swallow swords. Yeah.
Okay. His fence list is already maxed. He can't talk to you anymore.
I can't talk to you anymore. Exactly. Krabby got removed off my friends list. Make one more room. So if anyone needs a friend, I have an open spot now. No, I'm just kidding. Also, I think they also mentioned on here that it's not written down, but I saw it on Twitter from someone else that, and you can maybe tell me if I'm wrong here or if the person was blowing smoke up my bum, that they are releasing another ESO soundtrack on iTunes soon that's supposed to have all the new music on it.
I feel like I did hear them say something about that, but I can't confirm it.
Okay.
Blue Diamond, the sequel.
Blue Diamond, the sequel. Well, they've added a lot of different zone music, especially with Hrothgar, with Abba's Landing, Imperial City. My goodness, the opening theme that we use for our episode is not on the official soundtrack. It came in a later patch. I think it came with Hrothgar. It's really exciting because I love the music. I have all their soundtracks. I play them constantly because I love the music. So I'm excited about that.
Oh, did you hear the little snippet of music the guy played, the audio lead played on ESO Live?
Yeah, it's beautiful.
I think he said he had an acoustic guitar and he held it up and he played it with a, what the hell? It's one of the violin thingy stick, whatever.
The bow?
The bow, yes, the bow. He played it with that, and it actually sounded awesome. Oh, it sounded really good.
Yeah, I was gonna write that in here, but I didn't know how to word it out, so I
should have said acoustic guitar, violin stick.
Okay.
With violin stick.
I gotcha.
It was really cool though. The new music coming with this DLC sounds awesome.
It does sound really good.
Yeah.
Well,
they did a really good job.
Oh, that's awesome. I'm excited. Because I love the music. So whenever they release new music, I'm all over that. Because I just think it's fantastic. But that's me. All right. Well, guys, that is it for the news for this week. We're going to move right on into our Tales section. And I guess, who wants to go first? You know what? I'm going to go first. Because I haven't done a whole lot because I was unfortunately sick most of the week. Yeah. Well, it's because I had to wait till Krabby was offline to remove him from my friends list, so he didn't notice. I've been playing a little bit of my main character. I've been hopping into Cyrodiil from time to time, even though now I've kind of sat him aside because I'm kind of waiting for the next patch for when they reduce the amount of stuff I need to increase my skill lines because I'm sick and tired of Cyrodiil at the moment. Let's see. Oh, and Josh in chat. Okay, thanks, Avi. What do you use heavy and medium? Which slot? Chest heavy, and then either helm or legs medium. Your choice. One of the major slots. A lot of people go helm. I don't know why. But chest always heavy because it has the highest armor. Right.
A lot of people go heavy helm, medium shoulders, and the rest light. So when you get the monster sets, it'll even out.
That's what I do, but right now I don't have the helm to match my shoulders.
I'm kind of curious why people do that versus the other way, because the chest has a higher armor rating.
Well, it's more like you're getting prepared to get the monster set, so you're not going to have to recraft your chest piece again.
I guess. Makes sense. I guess it makes sense. I guess. Oh, all right. Yeah, so I've been doing that. I've been leveling my Dragon Knight, Khajiit. She is now level 46, and I got 3 levels in Maelstrom Arena because I was bored and watching some different streams, and one of the streamers, they were asking what's one of the best ways to level, and they're like, you should go try Maelstrom Arena. You really get some good experience in there. I've never actually seen this streamer before. I think he was a PvPer, so I really don't know who they were. But it was one of the only streams that was going on at the time. So I was like, you know what? Well, whatever. I'll give it a shot. So I went and gave it a shot, and I really did. I got like 3 levels. So, I mean, it kind of worked, but you can only do it like once a day. So, it worked for what I wanted it for. I started building a Magicka set again, but not for my main character this time. I'm actually only going to use it for an alt character because I have a second Templar, and I decided instead of constantly changing my build around to go Magicka now or go, you know, forget that. I'm just going to make it so that my second character is Magicka. So.
Yeah. You've timed that well with the temper Magicka's going downhill with the new patch. You thought you'd start a magic version.
Well, I've been thinking about doing a magic version for a while, but I just don't enjoy it. I don't know what about it. Like, even when you and I were talking before, trying to figure out what the heck I was doing wrong, I just don't enjoy it. Even though the survivability is there, I've actually decided to go more of a, that's why I changed my build to be kind of more of a mix between PvP and PvE. So I have a little bit more solo survivability for Maelstrom. So I'm going to be using Vigor as well as Rally. So I'll actually have 2 hots going on me at one time on my Templar, my Stamina Templar. And that shouldn't really be a problem at all. Like, it should be pretty easy. Like, I shouldn't have any issue at all. Like, it's just going to be amazing. I don't know. Maybe I'm crazy. But that's going to work out okay for me. Like, I feel like that's... I have enough healing at that point. And they also stealth nerfed biting jabs pretty hard. Or puncturing sweep, I guess I should say. So it costs more and doesn't heal for as much. So the main reason for really wanting to go... as a healer, or not healer, but a Magicka type Templar on my main has kind of been whatever. But given by how slow I level these extra characters, because I'd rather be playing on my main, I figure by the time that I get that far, it's going to be... they're going to remove the veteran ranks anyway, so I'll just make the gear VR16 and then throw it on an alt character. So I don't actually have to level it up. Since I already had 2 or 3 pieces already made, I just kept going with it. I missed our pledge night as well as our Thursday night event because I was stuck at work, and then Friday I was not feeling good. I actually wasn't feeling good yesterday either, but went for Valentine's Day dinner with Thais, had some fun times there. Other than that, that's really all I've done other than every day I log in and do my crafting dailies to get more pages. I finally got glass swords. That excites me because I love glass swords. But yay!
Nice.
Yeah. So that's kind of where I'm at. Crabby, why don't you go ahead and go next, and then Avi can follow that up.
Well, let's see. Let me go over the past 4 months since the last time I was on.
There we go.
Well, actually, no. So, I mean. I finally hit VR16 after like almost a year and a half since launch, so that's good. I've been doing a lot of crafting. Like every day I do all 3 writs, and I got 1 glass motif. Of course, it was the axes, which nobody cares about. So, yeah, no, I mean, I've been nothing too exciting. I've just been logging on, trying to do pledges every day with the guild and stuff. I mean... honestly, nothing too... I mean, we had the first trial a couple weeks ago. That was super fun. But I said that earlier.
It was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Are you getting a lot of activity in the guild with trials every day? Like, what time do you log in to do trials? Maybe that will... I would like to see more people active in the guild, even doing trial dungeons and stuff together.
Shamelessly promote your event.
Yeah. It's usually random. I mean, well, I don't schedule to do trials. I'll just, like, on the weekdays, I'll probably log in around 5, 6 o'clock and see if anyone's doing anything. I might get... There's usually a few people that are always willing to do trials.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, no, I mean, 5, 6 o'clock, I'll usually...
You mean pledges. We should say pledges.
Pledges, yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry, not trials, pledges.
Pledges.
But, yeah, 5, 6 o'clock. On the weekends, I'll just ask whenever.
Right. I want to get more activity within the guild because... As Asteldian will back us up, one of the major downfalls of ESO is the ability to really not need anybody to do almost anything other than trials and stuff like that. And you know, one of the things that really keeps people playing MMOs for long periods of time, you know, it's kind of like a mixed bag from both people. Content needs to be there, but also the community needs to be there. I mean, you can have really good content, but if your community leaves... You know, you're not going to have anyone to play with, and therefore you're not going to be able to do content, stuff like that. So I'm always encouraging people to get together, asking guild to do stuff, always asking guild before you do the dungeon finder. Like, that's a last resort. Always a last resort. All right, continue. I'm sorry. Just had to do my spiel.
No, I'm honestly pretty much done. You know, nothing too crazy. Nothing to note, really.
Right.
Yeah.
Have you been working on any alternate characters, or have you really just been one VR16 just doing everything you
can? No, I am never going to do silver and gold content to its fullest again, probably. But I guess when they remove VR, you don't really have to. But
they're also removing the restriction that you have to do one before the other. So
I will literally never walk into Green Shade or Groutwood ever again.
I don't blame you.
That is good.
Yeah, I think that's definitely a nice change that they've made, is that it's going to make the game feel very much open world, like Witcher or Skyrim. I mean, after your first initial, you know, you save the world, yippee-doo, right? You know, that's why you're kind of stuck in that theme park ride. Like, you have to go to these zones, you got to do this. But after that, I have the rest of Tamriel to explore. I can pick where I'm going. I'm not sent by Cadwell to go help Daggerfall or Aldmari or Ebonheart Pack. I can choose where I want to go. I think that's really cool. I think that's going to be really cool.
Yeah.
And Josh, see you later, man. Thank you for coming in chat, and hope you enjoy the rest of the podcast when you hear it next. So, cool. I had to say bye to people in chat, because I can. Avi, what about you, man?
All right, let me see where it is. I wrote a little bit of notes about what I did right here when I was doing the
pledge. You get an actual notebook that you break it out.
I do. Yeah, I wrote this while we were doing that event night on Friday. It says, ran pledges with Crabby, Ark, and War Wizard. And under Crabby, it says frustrated. Under Ark, it says tired. and under War Wizard, it says enjoying our craziness. So pretty much what happened is I had a hard time getting into this game that night.
45 minutes to do a pledge because Abby's freaking computer.
Well, yeah, what was wrong with the computer?
I didn't patch.
Oh.
So I had to wait to patch, and all of a sudden I got put in that infinite loading screen.
Oh, no.
And then we wanted to scale down the dungeon we were doing, so I had to log in on one of my lower tunes, get in it, and jump out. We had a bunch of problems doing that. Just didn't work out at all. And then finally, when we finally all get set up, we finished the dungeon in 10 minutes. So it took more time getting prepared to get in. But we had a good time, though. It was really funny. And then, you know, War Wizard was enjoying all of our craziness of, you know, yelling at each other. And
right.
He's a good dude. I like War Wizard.
Like War Wizard, too. He's a really good guy, part of the guild. I'm glad that he's been working really hard to get his character up, because, like, every time we've been doing events for the longest time, he's not had a character who could actually do stuff with us, and now he actually has one, so that's always exciting.
and he's a healer, so I got to play my Nightblade.
Oh, did you?
Yeah,
oh,
I got awesome. I got the DPS on my Khajiit, so probably the first time I pulled him out in a very long time. But it was fun playing him. You know, I wasn't used to being a Nightblade, so I was pretty much just spamming Steel Tornado. But it worked out for the most part.
So right.
It was a really good time. We had a fun night. We were gonna keep on going, but Ark was very tired that night.
Right.
Tired or beyond tired.
I mean, it was like 6 a.m. for him, so I don't really blame him.
Yeah.
Ark's always our go-to guy. Like, he's no matter what time, he's like, "Yep, I'm there." But he's always there so late, and I always feel bad, but you know, I'm glad that he got to show up and be part of the group. I really feel bad cuz I hate when I have to miss events. It drives me nuts. Now I'm all sad.
you missed it, man. It was a good time. Yeah. Me and Ark are planning on playing some Counter-Strike, so me and him are going to be venturing on into a new game for a little bit that we both used to play. So that should be fun too.
All right.
But in Tamriel, that's really about all I did. You know me; I've been mind sucked into The Witcher.
Yeah.
Completely drawn into it. I even got into this world and got into game, and I was like, Tamriel.
What is this?
I can't focus on two fantasy worlds at the same time. Oh my goodness, it's too overwhelming for me.
Gotcha. Yeah, and you got a long time yet with The Witcher. I know with The Witcher, it's. I'm like calling you and be like, dude, we need you for this. You're like, all right, I'm coming.
I just bought my first book on Audible.
Oh, you got
the very first Witcher book.
The Sword of Destiny or Blood of Elves.
Go away, Mom. Yeah, I'm in the middle of
my brother.
No, the audiobooks are really good.
Peter Kenny is fantastic as a narrator. He does the voices so well. He does a fantastic job. I cannot recommend the Witcher books more, especially if you like it.
I picked up The Last Wish, so.
Okay,
I don't know if you just said that. Sorry, they distracted me.
I didn't. I think that was like the first book that was released in the U.S., yeah. But chronologically, Sword of Destiny comes first.
Damn it, Wicked Wolf.
Yeah, chronologically, Sword of Destiny's first.
Wicked Wolf told me to download it, so.
Well, it's a good book, but if you want to follow the story, Blood of Elves is first.
Blood of Elves is the first book in the, series. Like the series stories.
Yeah. Sword of Destiny and...
Sword of Destiny and Last Wish are...
Short
story books, which are good. Okay. I would listen to those first because they kind of set up Geralt.
They do. And actually, they... And I know this is off topic for anyone who actually is listening, but they do set up the Ciri plot line with Geralt and Sentra in... you actually meet Ciri's grandmother, the line of Sentra, in The Last Wish. They mention her briefly and the Child of Destiny and all of that. So you do get a little bit of a backstory. So it's definitely worth it, but it's disjointed because it was a collection of short stories, whereas The Blood of Elves and those books are all chronologically following like a novel storyline.
Yeah, because this is one of those games that I jumped into and I had no idea what was going on. So, you know, it's like, I lost my memory. It's like he lost his memory. When did he lose his memory?
Unfortunately, the last two books are not translated into English yet.
That sucks.
So you will not be able to listen to the last two. I think it's the last two books. Or might be the last book.
Well, this book's 10 hours long, so it's going to take me a good while to get this one.
Man, that's like a day for me. But anyway. All right, off topic. We got to roll off on.
Yeah.
This is not a Witcher show. Albeit,
fun to do one sometime.
It would be fun, but anyway, that's beside the point. Let's see here. Asteldian, I don't know if you probably not had any gameplay for this.
No gameplay for me.
No. All right. Well, before we sign off then, I guess if anyone is indeed interested in joining us for any of our events at Wings of Fate, you can send any of us a message You can send me a message in-game at Aggelos, A-G-G-E-L-O-S, if you want an invite. We do pledge nights every Tuesday, which is just an organized night that we literally get together at like 7:30 at night and go, hey, let's all do pledges. Thursday nights at 8:30 is my world event night where I get together with people and I run some sort of open world event like Imperial City, Hrothgar, or Kraglorn, the ones that require groups of people. So that's on Thursday nights. And of course, Friday nights, Crabby is doing his endgame night, so we really need to get some more people together for trials, vet DSA, stuff like that. So if you're interested in any of that, you want to come hang out with us, send us a message, come on out, and you should have a really good time. I guess that's it, guys. Final thoughts? Let's go around and give everyone where they can find us, how they can contact us, et cetera, et cetera. We'll start with Avi.
Yeah, so it was a very good show. Crabby, nice having you on, I guess. Whatever. But yeah, where to find me? You can find me pretty much everywhere on PlayStation, in-game, on PC and ESO, Twitter, Steam. Anywhere you want to add me, I'm there. And that's at AviOptimal, AviOptimal.
Excellent. And Asteldian.
Yeah, it was nice having Crabby on the show, really. I don't think I was around the last time I was on. So, it's been a long time since we've been on the same show. It was enjoyable show to listen to you guys and your gameplay. I'm glad to see you still having plenty of fun. And you can find me at Asteldian on Twitter. And that's probably about it.
All right. Crabby, how about you, sir?
If anybody wants to check out my Twitter, it's at Crabby654, and that's my my ESO name too. need more for trials, especially healers. But I'm good. I'm good.
The little milk drinkers here now. Yeah. You going to tell people where you can follow you? Huh? Yeah? All right. Well, you can follow me on Twitter at Aggelos, @AggelosWF. You can follow me in-game. Send me a friend request. I'll make room. At Aggelos, @AggelosWF. Of course, you can send me a message for invites, etc., etc. You can follow the show at DungeonCrawlerNetwork.com, on YouTube.com/DungeonCrawlerNetwork. As well as our Twitter feeds at Tales of Tamriel and at Dungeon Crawl Net for the network as well. We hope that you enjoyed this episode and that we will see you next time in Tamriel. Everyone have a wonderful night.
The serpent lights the ancient sky of bread of tainted stars. Evil stirs, and in its wake the souls of mortals sway. And sorrow reigns over fields of red and spirit. Strive, reclaim every Dawn.